प्रॉपर्टी लॉ ट्रांसफर ऑफ प्रॉपर्टी एक्ट लेक्चर 7 से डियर स्टूडेंट फ्रेंड्स यू आर अवेयर दैट आई एम डॉक्टर रेगे सूर्य राव प्रिंसिपल रिटायर्ड एडेड लॉ कॉलेज महाराष्ट्र आई हैव बीन डिलीवरिंग लेक्चर्स ऑनलाइन सिंस मार्च 2018 दैट इज आफ्टर रिटायरमेंट आफ्टर माई रिटायरमेंट सो फार आई हैव डिलीवर्ड 122 लेक्चर्स दिस इज माई 123rd lectures out of 16 subjects. Few more lectures have to be uploaded on these 16 subjects, then I will proceed to 17th subject. And today I am going to take up sale from Transfer of Property Act from the subject Property Law. This subject, as I told you earlier, Property Law was earlier entitled Transfer of Property Act. Recently, this, however, the title is Transfer of Property Law, Transfer of Property Act is being talked. Now, so far, I delivered 6 lectures on this Transfer of Property Act, that is Property Law. In first lecture, I explained in brief various kinds of properties, tangible, intangible, and various kinds of different kinds of transfer of properties and respective law that regulate the transfers. In second lecture, I explained in brief part 1 of the TP Act, that is principles from section 1 to 53A. In third lecture, I enlightened you in brief specific transfers, that is from section 54 to 137. In fourth and fifth lectures, I explained in brief interpretation clause containing 7 definitions, in particular definition of immovable property. In sixth lecture, I completed in detail about section 6, which deals with what property can be transferred and what property cannot be transferred. I sincerely suggest you to take up your preparation as per the serial order I am following. I am delivering lectures as per importance of this chapter from examination point of view. As I told you, dear friends, the Transfer of Property Act 1882 contains two parts, split into two parts. Part 1, that is section 1, extent and applicability, section 2, repeal of act, section 3, interpretation clause, section 4 to 53A deal with various principles, section 54 to 137 deal with specific transfers. This categorization of principles and specific is there for so many subjects. In contracts 1 also you studied principles part 1, principles part 2, specific IPC part 1, contracts 1 to 75, principle 76 to end of the chapter 266, they are specific. In IPC 1 to 120, principles 120A, criminal conspiracy, which is both principle and specific, 121 to 511 specific, and like that. Similarly, this Transfer of Property Act also is split into two parts. So here I wish to advocate you as a senior friend of yours. This Transfer of Property Act principles somewhat technically difficult for an average student, but that is why I suggest you to take up, you give novel reading or follow my first 3 lectures for summary, and then you concentrate interpretation clause, in particular section 3. Then you proceed to section 6, what property can be transferred, what property cannot be transferred. Then you proceed to specific transfers, from section 54 to 137. In among these transfers, specific transfers also, in order of priority, which are important from examination point of view. How I am taking up lectures one by one, you follow accordingly. Now, I wish to take up sale, and after sale, the most next chapter is mortgage, next chapter is lease, next chapter is exchange, next chapter is gift, and last chapter is actionable claims. So, keeping in mind the significance and importance of the topics from examination point of view, I will take up today. I wish to take up sale, the first chapter from a specific specific transfers. Dear friends, from part 2, specific transfers, there are different kinds of specific transfers. As I have been telling you from the beginning, that the owner of the property, the person who is having title over the property, is having absolute right over the property. Absolute right in the sense, right to use or enjoy, right to mortgage, right to use or enjoy, right to lend, right to mortgage, right to lease, right to gift, and ultimately right to destroy. So the how he extends his right over the property, he may transfer the interest in property to another person absolutely or limitedly. So in this connection, we have to discuss about different categories of transfers. As told you several times earlier, that the Transfer of Property Act deals mainly with transfer of immovable property between two living persons. It also deals with transfer of movable properties. Under part 2, specific transfers, that is from section 54 to 137, these sections deal with sale. Section 58 to 104 deal with mortgage. Section 105 to 117 deal with lease. Section 118 to 121 deal with exchange. Section 122 to 129 deal with gift. And ultimately, last chapter, section 130 to 137 deal with actionable claims. So I let you know in brief what are these specific transfers in a single line, and then I will proceed to sale. Here, sale, you know, dear friends, in our regular course of life, this transfer of property by sale is quite obvious, quite natural. It may be the sale is a regular part and parcel of our life. There may be movable property and immovable property. Whatever goods and commodities we require, we purchase them. The corresponding aspect is sale. So that is why the sale refers to movable property, immovable property, tangible, intangible, etc. So a sale of a property between living person to another living person is governed by Sale of Goods Act 1930. I explained in you in detail in the contracts too. Sale of immovable property between one living person to another living person is governed by Transfer of Property Act 1882. Sale of intangible property, intellectual property, is governed by there are intellectual property legislations are there, Copyrights Act, Patents Act, etc. Similarly, so a person who has a title over the property is having absolute interest in the property. If he transfers his absolute interest to another person, that process is called sale. That is, absolute interest means right to use, right to enjoy, right to lend, right to lease, right to gift, and right to destroy, right to exchange, all these things. All rights are vested in that particular right. Next, the owner of the property who is having a title can mortgage the land, mortgage the property. Mortgage the property means if property is transferred from one person to another person for obtaining a loan as security, that is called if the property is immovable property, we call it as mortgage. If the property is movable property, we call it as pledge or pawn. A pledge or pawn. For example, if gold is pledged with bank, if gold is delivered with bank to obtain a loan, cash, that is if gold is movable property, when we deliver gold in bank for obtaining loan, it is called pledge. Suppose we pledge, we offer our house or landed property to bank for loan, it is called mortgage. The process is same, but it is movable property, we call it as pledge. If it is immovable property, we call it as a mortgage. Next, section 105 to 117 deal with lease. Lease means we can give our house to rent, we can give our rice mill to rent, we can give our any property on rent, we can, the owner of the land can give it on rent for revenue to some farmer. So that process is called lease. Dear friends, we are seeing there are so many educational institutions, they do not have, they may not have old own building, they take loan, they take the college building or school building on lease, either from government or from private party for 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, like this. That is, what is lease, what is what are the constraints of lease, all these things we have to discuss in due course of time. Next topic, next transfer of property is section that is exchange. Section 118 to 121 of Transfer of Property Act deal with exchange. Exchange means I give my house to you and you give my house to. So both are same value, I need not pay anything to you, you need not pay anything to me. That process is called exchange. That process is called exchange. So sometimes what happens is if my value of my house is more value, you will give your house and the difference value you will pay in money or in form of movable property or anything. So that is exchange. So the transfer of ownership, I give my property to you and then take your property to me, that is called exchange. And last fifth type of transfer of transfer of property is gift. Gift means giving donation. Suppose father gives his house on gift to his daughter or near, that is called gift. If any property is given without any consideration, without any price, absolutely free, that process is called gift. So a movable property can be given in gift and immovable property can be given in gift. But the exchange, in transfer of property under exchange, both movable and immovable properties are there. So here, out of these five kinds of transfer, this contract of sale is in a TP Act is exclusively related to immovable property. Mortgage is exclusively related to immovable property. Whereas sale, mortgage, lease, they pertain to immovable property only. When you study under Transfer of Property Act, the sale refers to immovable property only. Mortgage refers to immovable property. Lease refers to immovable property. Whereas exchange and gift refer to both movable and immovable property. Movable property can be given in gift. Immovable property can be given in gift. Both movable and immovable properties put together can be exchanged for equivalent value, and also it may contain some cash that is differential value. So the sale, mortgage, lease, exchange and gift are five categories of transfer of property which you study in this Transfer of Property Act. In the last topic for discussion is section 32-137, that is actionable claims. Actionable claim is an unsecured debt. Actionable claim. So, for better understanding of that, I wish you to draw your attention. Please watch my lecture under Negotiable Instrument Act in contracts to. I explained in detail Negotiable Instrument Act so that you can have a good idea about this. Actionable claim is a claim against which you can bring an action to get your relief, to get your benefit. To get your benefit, that is insurance policy is an actionable claim, mortgage is an actionable claim. There are the claim, actionable claim is that It is a written instrument against which one can bring an action in court of law to get your benefit. That is what is called actionable claims. That is last topic. I have enlightened you in brief about actionable clause in interpretation clause chapter. So if time permits, I will take up this also. Now, dear friend, today I wish to take up sale, one of the categories of specific transfer. Now, section 54 to 57 of Transfer of Property Act lay down the provisions relating to sale, in respect of immovable property. When you speak about a sale in TP Act, it must be absolutely immovable property. When you speak about a sale in a movable property, you have to refer this sale of goods act. Dear friend, because the concepts of the various concepts under sale are almost identical, not only for movable property but also for immovable property, I suggest you to verify my lecture on sale of goods act in transfer of sale of goods act in contracts to one or two lectures I have given, uploaded on sale. It contains so many issues: sale, agreement to sell, and rights and duties of seller and buyer, and implied conditions and warranties, caveat emptor, vendor's lien, nemo dat quid non habet, no one can convey a better title than what he himself has, and all these things, quantum merit, that is part performance, all the aspects I explained you in detail. Anyway, I will the only subject matter is different. Here in Transfer of Property Act, the subject matter is immovable property. In Sale of Goods Act, the subject matter is movable property. Other things, subject matter is the same. When you take life insurance policy, the subject matter is human life. When you take property insurance, the subject matter is property, like that. So now let us now discuss about sale. Section 54 to 57 of Transfer of Property Act 1882 lay down various provisions relating to sale. Now, section 54 defines the concept of sale. Sale, the meaning and definition I will tell you later. Then rights and liabilities of buyer and seller are explained under section 55. 54 defines sale, 55 contains various liabilities and rights and liabilities of buyer and seller. Buyer is also known as purchaser, seller is also known as vendor. Next, after the sector, section 56 deals with marshalling by subsequent purchaser. Section 57 deals with provisions, provision by court for encumbrances and sale, sale freed therefrom. So, or discharge of encumbrances on sale. So, what are these two, 4 points in brief? I tell you, you know, and then proceed to meaning, definition, elements, and other aspects of sale. So, 54 speaks about meaning and definition. I need not explain anything about it. 55, rights and duties of buyer and seller. And these are also before sale and after sale. We have to concentrate on caveat emptor, vendor's lien on this topic. 56, marshalling. Marshalling means adjustment. Suppose when we purchase, when a purchaser wants to sell a property, he must be very careful about that property. He must check whether that property is having any charge or attachment or anything. He must be very careful. Then only he should purchase the property. Suppose that property, it is immovable property, that property is purchased from a bank loan. Whether all the installments are cleared or not, whether it is mortgaged or whether it is given in gift to anybody. So, these type of attachments or charges or liens are called encumbrances. So, a property to be given in sale, an immovable property to be offered for sale must be free from encumbrances. It must not have been mortgaged, there should not be any house tax dues, there should not be any installment dues, there should not be anything. So here, when it is done, similarly, some properties can be given as a security. In commerce students know, fully secured debts are there, fully secured, partly secured, and preferential secured. Fully secured means when you give property worth 50 lakhs and take loan 25 lakhs, it is fully secured. When you take loan of 50 lakhs and give security of 25 lakhs, it is partly secured. If there is no, without any security, you can get the loan depending upon your goodwill. So that is why unsecured loan is the unsecured debt is the debt for which there is no any security. That unsecured debt is an actionable claim. Loan given in advance or loan given against promissory note, it is an unsecured debt and it is an actionable claim. So insurance policy, a provident fund claim, and all are unsecured claims. So like this, so marshalling, what do you mean by marshalling? Section 56 and from this chapter sale, and section 81 from the chapter marshalling, we discuss about this marshalling in detail. Marshalling means it is the doctrine of marshalling envisages equitable distribution of the proceeds of the property to the different creditors. This doctrine of marshalling, the purpose of doctrine of marshalling is to protect the interests of the creditors. In mortgage, the creditors are mortgages. In sale, the creditors are purchasers. Sometimes what happens is, the seller offers his immovable property for sale. Purchaser purchases all the money. But if the purchaser doesn't know that the property had already been mortgaged, there may be one mortgage or two mortgages. So where the seller has one or two or more than two properties, he has already mortgaged to another mortgagee and subsequently sells one of the properties, suppose a seller has three properties A, B, C. He has taken it A, B, C, three pro A and B. A seller has two properties, property A, property B. Property A is 50 lakhs, property B is 50 lakhs value. He took 25 lakhs from property A, 25 lakhs from property, he took 10 lakhs from property B. Then subsequently he sold property B to some X. Then what happens is some X purchased the property without any knowledge that particular property has already been mortgaged. In such case, what happens is, so the mortgagee has advanced 25 lakhs for one property, 10 lakhs for another property. 25 lakhs plus 10, 35 lakhs, plus interest on both the properties may be 5 lakhs, 40 lakhs. But the total value of property A and property B is 1 crore. So then, if suppose there is no purchaser, the mortgagee will ask the mortgagor to repay the money and take the property back, but the mortgagor is unable to pay, then the mortgagee will dispose of property A and property B, and dispose of the property. He will get his 25 lakhs plus 10 lakhs, 35 lakhs plus interest 40 lakhs, and if the property is sold for some 80 lakhs. So taking his 40 lakhs and remaining 40 lakhs, the mortgagee should return to the purchaser. But instead of that, when there is some third party claim, that is their purchaser, property B is already purchased, then what happened? The mortgagee should protect the interest of purchaser, and whatever liability is there on the property purchased is released. So this property B has mortgage of 10,000, but he will adjust that that mortgagee will make the second property free from any encumbrance, and hand over the, that is why, so that the purchaser will be relieved from the liability. So if the, provided there is no any previous claim on that second property, if any insurance claim or if any bank debts, if any any lawful consideration, provided there is no any previous charges or attachments or amounts payable to government and other, the mortgagee will adjust the surplus money against the purchaser and then give the balance to him. If there is no money remaining to meet the other equitable distributors, the second mortgagee cannot do anything. So this type of arrangement or adjustment in order to protect the creditor. So under section 56, the doctrine of marshalling is envisages to protect the interest of purchaser of the property which had already been mortgaged to somebody. And the doctrine of mortgagee, the doctrine of marshalling under section 81 in Transfer of Property Act, that is mortgage, the first mortgagee will protect the interest of the second mortgagee after meeting the claim of second mortgagee, the remaining value mortgagee will return to the mortgagor. So that is a mutual adjustment or accommodation among two mortgages, previous mortgage and subsequent mortgages in mortgage under section 81, and the mutual adjustment or accommodation or cooperation between mortgagee and purchaser in sale, that is studied under section 56. This is one thing. Provision by court for encumbrances and sale freed therefrom, that is the discharge of encumbrances on sale. Dear friends, when any individual wants to purchase any immovable property, he has to check the encumbrances certificate. He has to, that means, suppose I want to purchase any property, before going to purchase that immovable property, it may be land or building or anything, naturally they will ask link document from whom this seller purchased that property. Secondly, if we pay some amount in sub-register office or register office, they will give the property details, whether there is any encumbrance, whether any tax due, any government payments due, any installment due to bank, or any encumbrances are there, any charges, any liens, whether it is mortgage, whether it is given in lease, and any attachments are there against that property, can be known. So otherwise, when the property is lying in this, in court, in a court proceedings, in civil litigation, and when the if the owner of the property is a debtor, judgment debtor, and the debtor is unable to act in compliance to the court order to hand over the property and other thing, suppose if when the court gives decree to the plaintiff and attaches the property of defendant, if the defendant will not be able to execute the court order, then the plaintiff will again apply to the court, and the court will order the attachment of the property. If that property is having any charge or encumbrances, it must be freed, it must be made encumbrance free. For that purpose, the interested party can apply to the court so that the party will be allowed to pay the dues on that particular property. Then the property will become encumbrance free, and then the encumbrance free, and so that the property can be transferred easily. These are the various issues, section 54, 55, 56 and 57 of Transfer of Property Act 1882 laid down the provisions relating to sale. So here, dear friends, let us now discuss about the first point, sale meaning. Sale means, we know, transfer of property, movable property, immovable property, tangible, intangible, whatsoever, for any price. Price paid or promised, partly paid or partly promised, that is sale. The sale refers to movable property, that is sale of goods act, immovable property, transfer of property act, intellectual property like copyrights or patent rights, copyrights act is there, patent rights act is there. Now, sale is voluntary transfer of property from one person to another for price. For the sale is a process, sale is an act by which ownership of the property, title of the property, absolute interest in property is transferred from one living person to another living person, that is in respect of immovable property in TP Act, movable property in Sale of Goods Act. So the person for price, the price means something in return, that is cost of the property. The price sometimes paid, that is the paid, that means 100% payment is made, partly paid, 50% or 30% payment is made, or unpaid. So without making any payment, the seller may register the property in the name of the buyer. So in sale, the person who transfers the property is called seller or vendor. The person who purchases the property, to whom the property is transferred, that is transferee, is called buyer or purchaser. The contract between seller and buyer is called contract of sale. So now the sale is the transfer of absolute interest in immovable property from one living person to another living person in consideration or in return for price paid or promised, partly paid or partly promised. The person who transfers the property, that is transferee, is called vendor or seller. The other person to whom the property is transferred, that is transferee, is called purchaser or buyer. So this is the contract is called contract of sale. Section 54 of Transfer of Property Act defines sale as, section 54 defines sale. Sale is a transfer of ownership. Sale is a transfer of ownership in exchange for a price paid or promised, or part paid and part promised, the same things. So this is with reference to the sale. Now, ingredients of sale. In a transfer to constitute sale of immovable property, some conditions are to be satisfied, otherwise the sale is not valid. So the parties to contract of sale must be competent to contract within the meaning of section 11 and 12 of Indian Contract Act 1872, because the seller must be a major, buyer must be major. If buyer is minor, he must act through his next friend, that is guardian. So both the parties to sale must be majors, they must not be minors. Secondly, they, within the meaning of section 11 of Indian Contract Act, they must not be unsound, they must not be convicted person, either of the party must not be convicted, insolvent or bankrupt, not disqualified due to some reason or other reason. So the parties to contract of sale must be competent to contract within the meaning of section 11 and 12 of the Indian Contract Act. That is first point. Second point is, mere competence to contract is not enough. The person who wants to sell the property must have title over the property, must be the owner of the property. That is second condition. Similarly, the purchaser also must have capacity to purchase. Suppose the poor man wants to purchase a big palace, it is not there. So the purchaser must have ability to financial stability to purchase. The seller must have no title. So no one can convey a better title than what he himself has. If the seller doesn't have any title, he cannot do it. That is second thing. The subject matter, when we speak about the Transfer of Property Act, Transfer of Property Act, the subject matter must be immovable property. So movable property cannot be transferred under this TP Act, because if movable property is there, the law governed the Sale of Goods Act. That is why, for the purpose of sale, the sale under Transfer of Property Act must be immovable property only. So next, secondly, the transfer must be voluntary. So there should not be any compulsion. It should not be subject to any compulsion, coercion, undue influence, fraud, misrepresentation, etc. So it must be voluntary transfer. Secondly, transfer of convenience. The delivery of the property must be there. So the property must be transferred from one person to another person. That is, should be there. And ultimately, the consideration must be there. So a contract act tells you ex nudo pacto, not arbitrio out of a note bag, no cause of action arises. For every contract of sale, there must be consideration. The consideration means something in return, that is a price. That is the price. So the price may be paid or promised, partly paid or partly promised, partly paid or partly promised. So if the property house is 50 lakhs, 50 lakhs may be paid on the spot and the contract can be accomplished, and 25 lakhs is paid now and 25 lakhs may be paid later. The seller will be ready to register the house in favor of buyer, and without any receiving any money, if the seller is interested, he can register the house in favor of buyer without receiving any money. So if in first case 100% is paid, no problem, fully paid vendor. Suppose partly paid or unpaid, the seller's status is called unpaid vendor. If the payment is not made, the vendor can exercise lien over the property and can take the property back. This vendor's lien I will tell it, you know, in due course. So this is what is called, these are the ingredients of sale. Next one, and sale and agreement to sell. Sale and agreement to sell is when the parties enter into contract of sale. Sometimes the contract of sale is completed or accomplished on the spot. The registration is completed, then it is called sale. So the contract of sale is completed, we call it as sale. So if the property title of the property title of the property got transferred from seller to buyer, and the property is vested in buyer, the process is called sale. So sometimes what happens is the buyer and seller enter into an agreement towards existing property or future property. Sometimes the builder may have at the time of foundation stone, he enters into contract with the party for. So today there is only land. After 2 years, the flats will be ready. Some of multi-storied building will be completed, and then the flats will be handed over. At that time, buyer and seller enter into an agreement, that is called agreement to sell, agreement to sell, or contract of sale. So already some flats are readily available. If the buyer cannot pay the 100% amount, he will pay some amount and take agreement, that is called agreement to sell. So if the builder has a lot of confidence on buyer, he may execute sale also, accepting little money. But generally the builder is unknown to the customer. When the property, the flat is 50 lakhs, the buyer will pay some 1 lakh or 2 lakh money, token money, and register the flat. That is called agreement to sell. And that is why the agreement to sell or contract of sale may be with reference to property already in existence or future property also, property to be in existence. Similarly, movable property, the movable properties like cars, scooters, TVs, fridges, if they are readily, they may be readily available in showroom stock, they will be arriving in a near future. For that, agreement to sell may take place. So, sale and agreement to sell, some slight differences are there. In sale, the subject matter is immovable property with reference to existence for existing property only, not for any movable property. For agreement to sell, the subject matter may be existing immovable property or future immovable property to be existed in future. Then sale is completed, accomplished contract, means executed contract. Agreement to sell is executory contract, the contract to be executed in course of time. Third, in sale, the ownership is vested in buyer. In agreement to sell, the ownership retained with seller. So these are the differences between sale and agreement to sell. Then ingredients I have completed. So here, next section 55 of Transfer of Property Act lay down various provisions related. Section 55 of Transfer of Property Act 1882 lays down various provisions relating to rights and duties of rights liabilities, rights and duties of buyer and seller. This topic, the headings of rights and duties are mostly common in so many topics. The rights and duties between a bailor and bailee, rights and duties between pledger and pledgee or pawner and pawnee, rights and duties between principal and agent, that so many things are common, dear friend. But the headings are common, but the content is slightly different. So you can manage with the common side headings, I need not spend much time for this topic. And however, before completion of sale, one topic is there. After completion of sale, is one topic is there. Before completion of sale, these one is KVA tempter and the second one is vendor. The KVA tempter is a concept before sale, and vendor's lien is a concept after sale. These two protect the envisage protection to seller only. However, there will be some exceptions. Now, KVA tempter. What do you mean by KVA tempter? I explained this topic in detail in Sale of Goods Act. You refer to my lecture. KVA tempter means let buyer beware. Let buyer beware. So, when we go to some shops or malls, shopping malls, we naturally find some board. That board stating, some name board is there, stating the contents. Once goods sold should not be returned. Or cannot be accepted. Once goods sold, cannot be accepted back. Like that board. So, dear purchaser, let buyer beware. Dear buyer, dear purchaser, beware. Check, examine very carefully what goods you want to purchase. What property it may be. In Sale of Goods Act, it is movable property. In immovable property. Before purchasing, suppose you want to purchase a flat, purchase a house, you check the house carefully whether there are any defects or any encumbrances and everything. When once the property is sold, the buyer cannot raise any objections. That is, it is a protection, it is a defense to the seller or vendor. So, the buyer is expected to examine very carefully before before completion of the sale. When once the contract of sale is completed, subsequently, the buyer cannot raise any objection or query with reference to the property. That is what the KVA tempter or let buyer beware. So, it clearly means buyer be careful. Means it is protection to vendor. But this concept of this doctrine of KVA tempter helps, provides defense to vendor or seller from patent defects only, not from latent defects. Defects are two categories, patent defects, latent defects. Suppose a man is seen cold and cough, sneezing and coughing, then we say that his defect is latent. Suppose he is suffering from BP, sugar, it is latent defect. He has some heart trouble, it is latent defect. Suppose a man is physically handicapped, it is a patent defect. So he has some kidney problem or lung problem, it is a latent defect. So, patent defects are traceable, detectable, visible. This is this. Latent defects are invisible, not traceable. Invisible or not traceable. Not invisible or not traceable. So, this is this. So, the vendor can claim defense for patent defects only, not for latent defects. Suppose purchaser purchased some house, there is some drainage problem which he could not detect at the time of purchase. After completion of sale, after few days, there is leakage in a bathroom, there is leakage in lavatory, and there is some internal pipes are defective and all. Then they are called latent defects. But if he complains to vendor must correct them. He cannot say that he cannot take the defense of KVA tempter. So that is why in the case, there is a relevant case on this point, Sheikh Buddhan Saab vs. Nagamma, Andhra Pradesh High Court judgment. In this case, it was held that the doctrine of KVA tempter is not no more a defense in respect of latent defects. So this is. Next one is, after completion of sale, the vendor or seller is having one right, that is called vendor's lien, seller's right. So, you know, dear friend, a contract of sale can be executed for 100% payment or 50% payment or 10% payment or no payment. So, the price paid, partly paid or unpaid. So unpaid. Suppose, if it is 100% paid, okay. If even 1% is not paid, that the seller is called unpaid vendor. the unpaid vendors. So in sale of in suppose you purchase a flat taking bank loan, you bank loan, and if you don't pay some 60 installments are there, you have paid from 50 more than 50 installment, you don't pay even one installment, you don't pay, the banker will have a lien over your property. That is called vendor's lien. Suppose here, suppose you purchased the property from a seller, not builder. So suppose builder without any bank loan gave you on promissory note or something, and that builder is a vendor, you are a purchaser. So once you purchase the property, you are expected, you are supposed to pay 100% payment. Even 1% payment is not there, the seller will have the right of, will have the right to take the property back. That is why in movable property sale of goods act, when we purchase cars, two-wheelers, four-wheelers, or auto rickshaws, any tractors, TVs, fridge, everything, when the installments are there, and we people say that I purchased the movable property in installment, that is not correct. Installment, commerce students are expected to know what is installment, what is hire purchase. It is not installment, it is hire purchase. So when 20 installments the property is purchased, 19 installments paid and one installment is not paid, the seller of the property, that is, can exercise vendor's lien and take the property back. Similarly, house, 10% is not paid, 90% is not paid, but still the 10% is he will get vendors, he will get right to take the property. The right to take the property back is called lien. So the word lien means right to retain till the dues are cleared. So the lien means, so the lien is two categories, one is general lien, other is particular lien. The tailor, you give your property, if you give your pant and shirt cloth worth of 5,000 to tailor, you have to pay some 500 or 600 rupees stitching charges. If you don't pay the stitching charges, the tailor can exercise lien over your suit, pant and shirt. Until and unless you pay his stitching charges, he need not give the pant and shirt for you. That tailor's right over, similarly laundry, similarly garage. Suppose when you give your car in garage for servicing, the servicing charges are some 8,000 to 10,000, and you have to pay the servicing charges and take your car back. If you don't pay, the garage owner can have Maruti showroom owner or any other showroom owner can exercise the lien over the property. Similarly for immovable property, that is, the lien means right to retain. So these liens against property particular liens, special liens. So general lien in the sense banks, government authorities will exercise that general lien. Suppose you have pledged your 1 lakh gold with a bank and took loan of 50,000, and you did not release the gold for a long time, then the interest will be increasing day by day, and the principal amount per interest will exceed 1 lakh rupees. It is the total, it may become 1,20,000. The pledger thinks that no, why should we release that gold? If we release that gold, its value is only less than 1 lakh, but the liability is 1,20,000, and the pledger, the customer, intelligently doesn't release it. That's why we see in so many newspapers, so many banks are putting the gold jewelry in auction. So if the bank recovers 100% value, it will keep quite surplus, if any, it will be given to the customer, that is the pledger, by crediting his account. Suppose the amount after dispose of this court will give notice to the pledger, several pledger do not turn out, the bank will give warning, we will put it in auction. Still the pledger is silent, then the bank will sell the gold in open auction. If the amount is not enough, then the bank will have right to exercise lien over other. If the customer is having any other property, it will exercise. It has any fixed deposit, it will attach, it has any sales account balance is there. So not only the property, the right over, not only the property, but also the other properties which the customer or pledger is having, that is called generally right to exercise not only the specific property but also other properties called generally, but the right to retain the particular property only, that is called specific lien or particular lien. Tailor's lien, garage owner's lien is particular lien or special lien. Bank's right over customer's property is general lien. So this is with reference to sale. And next, 55, section 56, 55 is over, section 56 speaks about marshalling. Section 56 of the TP Act speaks about marshalling. Marshalling means adjustment or arrangement to protect. Section 56 of Transfer of Property Act speaks about marshalling. Speaks about marshalling by subsequent speaks about marshalling by subsequent purchaser. Marshalling by subsequent purchaser. Section 81 of the Transfer of Property Act speaks about the marshalling by subsequent mortgagee. So here, where the seller of the property mortgaged the immovable property to, mortgaged one or more properties to one mortgagee or two mortgages, and subsequently he sells one of the mortgaged property to the purchaser. So the purchaser, suppose the seller has two properties, A and B. So purchase, subsequently he sold B to some purchaser. The purchaser, the property B is 50 lakhs. Purchaser paid 50 lakhs. Purchaser paid 50 lakhs. So purchaser is entitled to take the property B. But unfortunately, the purchaser doesn't know that property B had already been mortgaged to some X for some 10 lakhs. So he has already paid 100% payment of 50 lakhs that mortgage in order to get the property B from encumbrances. The purchaser cannot pay 10 lakhs plus this thing. For this purpose, the purchaser will request the mortgagee, "Dear sir, you have two properties, property A and property B of that X. So after recovering the money, when the seller is unable to release the mortgage, and when once you sell the property, after realizing your money, after the mortgagee, after realizing his amount, suppose he gave 25 lakhs to one property, 10 lakhs to second property, and then he will give the remaining. So then he will say, so don't, that second property B has already been have purchased that. So out of the surplus amount, he released my property purchased and this thing. So then the mortgagee, keeping in mind the interest of the purchaser should not suffer, then the mortgagee should take into consideration interest of the innocent purchaser who did not have any knowledge about the encumbrance on some particular property of the, out of the surplus amount, after realizing his liability, the surplus, without giving back the entire surplus to seller, he releases the debt under the property which had already been sold and give the remaining. That type of mutual arrangement to protect the creditor, to protect the purchaser, the arrangement or adjustment cooperation given by mortgagee in favor of purchaser in respect of sale, and sub one mortgagee in respect, the cooperation adjustment done by subsequent mortgage in favor of subsequent mortgage is called marshalling. That type of mutual arrangement or adjustment to resolve the conflict of interest to the best satisfaction of all concerned is called the marshalling. This is what is called doctrine of marshalling. Dear friends, I forgot to tell you one case from vendor's lien. In vendor's lien, there is one case, Webb versus McPherson, W-E-B, Webb versus MacPherson. In this case, what happened? This is pre-counts judgment. The vendor is entitled to get the property back. In this case, what happened was, the seller by name Lloyd sold his estate to MacPherson. The owner of the property estate, Lloyd, sold the estate to one person, MacPherson, for 80,000 rupees. 30,000 rupees was paid by MacPherson, and 50,000 will be agreed to be paid in installment, but MacPherson did not pay the installments. Meanwhile, Lloyd died. His legal executor Webb filed a case against the purchaser for recovery of 50,000 plus interest. So, you know, dear friend, when a person dies, his property will be transmitted to the legal heir, either by legal heir. Suppose he receives a will, as per the will, the property will be distributed to the legal heirs or whomsoever he contain, whose names are contained in the will. So, the person, after the death of a person that is deceased, there will be some executor that is called legal executor. Who is that legal executor? He is mentioned by the deceased person. If the name of the legal executor is not mentioned, the court will appoint a person that is called administrator. So, the person who takes the responsibility to dispose of the properties of a deceased person among the persons whose names are mentioned there in the will, if the person already appointed by the deceased person during his lifetime is called legal executor, and legal executor is not named in the will by the deceased person during his lifetime, the court will appoint that man is called administrator. Administrator and legal executor both have same rule to take care of the property, to distribute the same among the persons who are entitled to inherit the property or get the property as named in the will by the deceased person. This is the very same. So, marshalling is over. Last one is section 57 speaks about discharge of encumbrances. So, section 57 of the Transfer of Property Act speaks about discharge of encumbrances on sale, encumbrance and court sale. So, the word encumbrance has not been defined under Transfer of Property Act. The legal parlance, the word encumbrance signifies a claim, charge or liability or lien attached to the immovable property. Encumbrance, I already told you, when any individual wants to purchase any immovable property, he must examine and check that property is free from encumbrance. That means it has not lent to anybody, it has not been mortgaged, it has not been leased out, it has not been gifted, and there is no tax area, any taxes, whether any tax is payable to municipal authorities or municipal council or municipal corporation, whether any amount is payable to the housing authority from whom from which the part have purchased, whether there are any installments remain unpaid to the buyer. So all these things are called liabilities, attachments, mortgages, etc. will lessen the value of the property. So these are called encumbrances. So encumbrances, the one who wants to find out the encumbrances, if any, on the immovable property, should apply in the office of the registrar by making a requisite fee, so that he will get a certificate of encumbrance. That certificate is called encumbrance certificate. We are basing on having gone through the contents of the encumbrance certificate, the purchaser who wishes to purchase who proposes to purchase that particular property can have an idea whether the property is free from any encumbrances or not. Then only he can come forward without doing anything. So sometimes it takes place. Sometimes what happens, the encumbrances are lying, but the debtor, one of the creditors filed a case against the owner of the property. The court gave decree in favor of the creditor. Then the judgment debtor is not able to meet the claim as per the court order. then again plaintiff will approach the court for execution of decree. Then the court will take up the execution of decree. In that process, the property may be attached. When once the property is attached, that property cannot be sold in auction or otherwise when there is an encumbrance. So the property to be disposed of or sold, it must be made encumbrance free. For that purpose, the interested party, that is the decree holder or a concerned, any other concerned person, will apply to the court on requisite fee, and the court may permit the party interested to make it encumbrance fee. The court will allow or permit the party concerned on requisite fee and get the property freed from encumbrance. That is what section 57 of the Transfer of Property Act speaks about. Dear friend, this topic sale I have completed in detail. So, from specific transfers, mortgage is a very important topic, and lease and gift are very easy. I will take up lease and gift in one class or two class. Then mortgage is very difficult topic. In mortgage, meaning and definition of mortgage is there, kinds of mortgage is there, the short notes may come, and doctrine of marshalling is there, doctrine of contribution is there, doctrine of subrogation is there. These topics are there. Thank you very much, dear friends, for your patient hearing. In this class, I forgot to give acknowledgement. So now let me pray God, pay homage to my reverend parents, late Rega Parav and late Srimati Kanta Ratnam. Let me express my deep sense of gratitude to all my godfathers, in particular the management, PDP Law College, PDP Aided Law College, Fulton, Satara District, Maharashtra, India. I would be miserably failed if I don't salute the soil of Maharashtra for providing shelter, and if I don't salute the great state of Maharashtra for having provided handsome salary with decent position and enough pension after retirement. I must be extremely grateful and deeply indebted to soil of Maharashtra and the great state of Maharashtra, dear friends. And above all, equally, all are 50%, and the contribution of my students is 50%. My parents, godfathers, all are 50%. My students are the state great soil of Maharashtra and government of Maharashtra, all are 50%. My student friends are 50% instrumental for my growth and development. I salute you with my folded hands, dear friend. Dear students, I sincerely suggesting you, like your uncle or elder brother or something, don't neglect. So acquiring knowledge is a great opportunity. Without knowledge, you can get through exam, you can get through as an advocate or judge, as thing. When once you have knowledge, if you are a lawyer, knowledgeable lawyer, the judge cannot question you. The judge also will think and act. That is the greatness of knowledge. That is the greatness of knowledge. So don't, but I don't like to mention the names and things. So if you go to court, you are going to witness. If you observe the press and social media, you are going to observe this thing. So that is why my classes are rarest opportunity. Only one man possessing experience in teaching 32 years, authoring, I have authored, I possess 32 years of teaching experience. I got an opportunity to teach almost all subjects. I have authored more than 30 books, and 22 books have been translated into Hindi. My books are in very good circulation all over India and abroad, and I am receiving a lot of appreciations. And secondly, I had an experience of visiting so many colleges in 3-4 states in delivering lectures, and I served a lot to my students before, one day before examination, delivering lecture whole subject. And with this, all this experience, I am taking all subjects Number of subjects, every subject I am giving detailed note. Every lecture is 1 hour and above 1 hour. So only one teacher in one channel, one teacher is teaching in a very, very simple way to the satisfy to the requirement of student. Suppose I give lecture to meet the requirement of students of high candidature who are prosecuting legal education in national law schools and prestigious institutes of legal study. This students, average students cannot understand. Suppose I deliver lecture keeping in mind the requirement of average students and BORL student, these lectures can be utilized. Lectures designed to average students can be better utilized, easily utilized by the merit student. But the lectures are designed to merit student cannot be utilized properly by the average student. That is why after give me an opportunity to serve you better. There are number of centers of legal education where there is no any minimum infrastructure. So for 30 subjects, including a 3-year law course, including specialization, there will be around 35 subjects. So for that, there must be not less than 15 lecturers. If the sections are more, accordingly, the next staff should be increased. And in many institutions, many centers of legal education, adequate number of teachers are not available. And the teachers will readily accept the word of principal or head of the department to accept any work. But when once the head of the department of principal asks the teacher to take more and more subject, change the subject, the teacher will feel inconvenience because accepting new subject, preparing for new subject, delivering lecture is not an ordinary task. It is a very difficult task. A student can write whatsoever he likes in exam, he can write. But the teacher cannot speak whatsoever he likes in classroom. He must have good preparation, thorough preparation, and should deliver the class in the classroom. Otherwise, he will become he will lose reputation among the students. So that is why, dear friends, I have uploaded 123 lectures on 16 subjects. I sincerely pray God to give me enough strength to deliver more and more lectures. If by the time I completed 300 lectures, these 30 subjects will be completed, and thereafter